shortly after midnight.
Rapper Chris Wallace, better known as
Notorious Big, B.I.G.
Notorious B.I.G. was shot and killed in Los Angeles early Sunday morning.
With more than 100 witnesses to a very public murder, there have been no arrests in the case.
The Notorious B.I.G. murder case has remained open for more than 4 years, producing an endless cycle of rumors, but no official suspects.
Who killed my son? And why? That's the question.
But answers have been slow to come. And a detective who worked the case believes he knows why. He says he has evidence that raises questions about the involvement of corrupt cops. Evidence he claims the Los Angeles Police Department is trying to bury.
Clearly, the department was trying to cover this whole thing up. Justice has not been done yet.
Before he was known as Biggie Smalls or the Notorious B.I.G., he was Christopher Wallace, an 8-pound baby boy born to a Jamaican mother in Brooklyn, New York in 1972.
I loved my baby. My love was very special because it was just the two of us, my son and myself, my Christopher and me.
Christopher's father left when he was 2, so Valletta Wallace raised her son alone in a small apartment in Brooklyn's rough Bedford-Stuyvesant neighborhood.
I worked, put clothes on my baby's back, food on my baby's table. I mean, I wasn't rich. I wasn't wealthy, but I was rich at heart.
Valletta was a devout Christian who scrimped and saved her teacher's salary in order to send Christopher to Catholic school.
My son was no product of no street. My son was a gentle human being. The street is not gentle. The street is not kind.
The neighborhood kids tease Christopher about his weight and the thick glasses he wore to correct his lazy eye. But Valletta taught her son to strike back with words, not fists.
If somebody heard you say no, look at the person and tell the person, don't you ever touch my body because that hurts. And I don't like it when you do that. I would tell him, please use your words. Please express yourself. Because if you don't express yourself, no one will know what you're feeling.
Bed-Stuy was a dangerous place to grow up in the 1980s. The invasion of crack cocaine had created an environment steeped in cheap drugs and street violence.
Growing up in the streets of Bed-Stuy was hard, Joe. Either you were stealing or you was hustling. One of the two, or you was a nobody.
Remember back in the days, had Wayne.
For years, Christopher's mother wouldn't allow him to stray from their front stoop, forbidding him to venture even a half block away to the corner of Fulton and St. James, where all the kids hung out.
At the barbecues, drinking brews, with the neighborhood crews hanging on the avenue.
I was afraid of death. I was afraid of drugs. I was afraid of the cops. I was afraid of everything. Everything that was bad. Because I know they weren't sitting here learning the ABCs. You know, whatever they were doing, it wasn't good.
Man, real shit happening, that's all. Money, hoes, anything.
Jobs, robbery,
get them.
We're just doing the regular things, you know, a young guy would do, selling drugs, just to get money in your pocket. We didn't know what was wrong, we was just trying to eat.
Who wants to hang around in the house with a 35 or 37-year-old mother? You know, I wasn't going to shoot dice inside there. I wasn't going to experiment on beer or on cigarette or marijuana. God knows what they were experimenting on out here.
At 13, Christopher joined the gang on the corner. They gave him the nickname Big and schooled him in the ways of the hustle.
I'm a bad friend. Lock your windows, close your doors.
To me, man, I feel like I was the bad influence. You know what I'm saying? Because when I introduced him to the game, he just, like, got addicted to it.
By the age of 16, Biggie was packing pistols and selling crack, pulling in up to $2,000 a week.
Give me the loot! Give me the loot! I'm a bad friend. Give me the loot! Give me the loot! I'm a bad friend.
Everybody want, you know, America, with your so-called American dream, house, car. You see, the finest cars come through every day, so we want those cars. We see the guys come through with nice girls, we want those girls.
Big was a natural at dealing, but when he was 17, he discovered another talent.
He would write a rhyme about what you're wearing. Right there, you know what I'm saying? He'll rhyme about that.
Big polished his skills by competing in rap battles on the street corner.
Battle for all the mixtapes, who the best, everybody banging in the garbage cans, getting a good beat.
Everybody would be just clapping and having a ball.
Part of what shaped the form them in the big.
Said, Mom, you see all that noise that we're making here? This music that you're calling noise? It's going to make us very, very rich one of these days. And I would laugh at him, please. Biggie.
Convinced he had found his calling, Biggie dropped out of high school when he was 17 and started recording demo tapes with a neighborhood DJ.
A whole lot of want Big to make a demo tape. Yo, 50, what's this?
It's a demo. Well, me and my DJ, 50 grand, was in the basement, you know what I'm saying, just making tapes.
We did a demo, three songs, straight ghetto, straight basement.
Because you know what Big Man's about to do?
He let my man Mr. C hear it, Big Daddy Kane's DJ.
It was just incredible rhymes, incredible delivery, incredible metaphors.
Mr. C let my man Matty C hear it from the Source magazine.
One or two bars. And Big had you on that tape.
They put us in the magazine.
Matty C profiled Biggie in Source Magazine's Unsigned Hype column. That caught the attention of the 22-year-old vice president of Uptown Records, Sean Puffy Combs.
I fell in love with him for the first time I heard his voice.
Mesmerized by the power of his rhymes, Puffy immediately summoned Biggie and his manager, Mr. C, to his office.
The first thing that he says is, yo, I want you to rhyme right now. Just rhyme. No music, no nothing.
He rhymed for me live. You know, I just didn't want him to stop. You know what I'm saying? It just sounded so good. It sounded so refreshing.
And after Big kicks the rhyme, Puffy says, I can have a record out on you by the summer. Would you be cool with that?
It's all good, baby.
Big with the nonchalant attitude. He was like, whatever, money. You know, whatever you want to do, man. You know, just talk to C, man. You know, whatever you want to do, we make it happen.
I love it when you call me Big Pop, the show stop, the rock drop, super tap.
It was the summer of 92, and 20-year-old Christopher Wallace had just scored a recording contract. It was just in time, because he was about to have a family to support.
He can't take it no more.
He was playing a dice game, and he was like, this was for my baby or whatever. And I was like, what do you mean, baby? You got a new girlfriend? And he was like, no, Jan's pregnant.
In August of 1993, Biggie and his girlfriend Jan had a baby girl they named Tiana.
The little girl came into the world, and I've never seen him with so much smiles. He adored his baby.
He was Jipper Skipper. That's the first time I ever seen that. He was happy, dude. He was like, yeah, time to get some money. That was his goal. He was like, yeah, I'm just getting money now.
I was trying to get larger and larger because I know that I got to secure our future.
Biggie didn't marry his girlfriend, but he was determined to support his child. The cash from his record deal was slow to come at first, so he continued to hustle.
I wasn't selling drugs just to be selling drugs, you know what I'm saying? I had a baby, I had to work, you know what I'm saying? Do my thing to feed my family, you know?
Put the drugs on the shelf, nah, couldn't see it. Rap was secondary, money was necessary.
You know, he still was hustling at the time, but not telling Puffy that he was hustling.
But when Puffy discovered Big had made a trip down south to sell crack in the fall of 93, he called him and begged him to stop dealing.
I just pleaded with him. Like, please come back. Don't do this to your life, you know? I mean, you don't need that. That right there, that's short money right there.
Things done change.
Puff sent Biggie a train ticket, and he returned to New York the next day, agreeing to give up dealing once and for all.
You know, he would always tell me, you know, this better work out, because I really could have made a lot of paper down there.
I'm definitely glad, you know what I'm saying, that I'm out the game because it don't bring nothing but death. But at the same time, I can't knock it because I learned a lot from it.
Coming up, Biggie finds faith and falls hard. Maybe this can last
forever. We just met and clicked, and he said, you know, we should just get married. I was like, are you serious?
And then a shooting turns friends into enemies and ignites a bi-coastal battle.
Yo, they got Pac laid down on the ground with a gun to him.
With Behind the Music continues.
Damn, why they gonna stick me for my paper?
The Notorious B.I.G. was putting his street life on record in the summer of 1994. The 22-year-old was laying down tracks for his debut album, Ready to Die.
The transition from selling drugs to the game is like, it's been sharp. Like, you know, I mean, I was a hustler, and then boom, I was a rapper. I'm living every day like a hustle, another drug jungle.
Biggie poured the struggles of his hustling days into his lyrics, creating complex and potent rhymes about ghetto life. Baby on the way, mad bills are
paid. That's why you drink Tangerine. When you dead broke, and your baby moms is yapping, and your daughter crying, and your moms is yapping, and you stressed out, man. You know what I'm saying? And sometimes it just be like, I just wish I was dead so I wouldn't have to go through the problem. I don't want to live no more.
It's not easy being young and black, living in the hood. And that's what he was just expressing, the frustrations, the emotion.
While he was recording the album, Biggie started hanging out with Tupac Shakur, a fiery and charismatic rapper from the West Coast, who was one of hip-hop's fastest rising stars. Tupac was in New York making his film debut when he first met Biggie.
As soon as they met, they became like best friends. Biggie slept on his couch. Tupac kind of mentored him in terms of like getting into the industry.
He knew that Pac was real, you know, that Pac was being real with him. And that's rare in this industry.
Biggie was also forging a strong bond with the man who signed him, Sean Puffy Combs, or P. Diddy, as Biggie liked to call him.
Check it out. This my man, the Notorious B.I.G.
What's the deal? What's going on?
Puffy brought Big with him when he left Uptown Records to create his own label, Bad Boy.
Bad Boy for life.
Puffy assembled his new Bad Boy family for a photo shoot in July of 94. That's where Biggie first laid eyes on an up-and-coming R&B singer named Faith Evans.
I was sitting at the lunch table, the table in the lounge area, having a break, and I think I was looking at some photographs, and he asked, could he see my pictures? So that was the beginning of Big and I.
Big convinced Faith to give him a ride after the shoot, and he charmed her the entire way home.
During the whole ride to Brooklyn, he was telling jokes about everything and everyone. He had me laughing the whole time.
Any female that's been around him will tell you he's real charming.
He was smooth with it, man. If a girl was weak-minded, she was caught.
Something about him was very warm and cozy, you know, like my daddy. You know how some women call their man their daddy. He was that type of guy, just very warm and caring and physical.
He had never met anyone like Faith, and he knew that from the second that he met her, that he was in love with her.
Biggie wasted no time. Within 2 weeks of meeting Faith, he proposed.
He said, you know, we should just get married. And, you know, I didn't take it as a joke. He didn't really say it in a joking way. I was like, are you serious? I mean, I did ask him, but I like, you know, are you serious? Like, yeah, let's do it. I was like, okay.
Biggie and Faith went to a justice of the peace and exchanged vows on August 4th, 1994.
The simplest way to put it is we were young and probably a little rebellious and in love.
They moved into an apartment together in Brooklyn, but the honeymoon wouldn't last long. Their rise to fame would breed jealousy, envy, and betrayal.
That marriage never had a chance. Never, never had a chance.
Coming up, Biggie's wife becomes a target for Tupac's innuendo.
I just want to send a shout out to Faith. Hey, girl.
I'm like, wait a minute. I mean,
what? I was angry at first. Like, no, that's not true. Like, that didn't happen.
And then the feud begins.
The East Coast ain't got no love for Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg and Death Row.
You couldn't believe how much people had invested in this beef and how much people believed.
I think somebody was trying to kill me. I'd be waking up paranoid. I'd be really scared to death.
When Behind the Music continues.